Hey, hi everyone. I'm Swaroop. I'm currently working at Fidelity Investments. So I'll be talking about recommender systems. So I mean, just for an idea's sake, I mean, can you just raise your hands if you are aware of recommender systems? Cool. So I can't bullshit. So I'll be the agenda being I'll talk what recommender systems are, the most popular algorithms, collaborative filtering, content-based, and matrix factorization. I mean, with few tweaks, and then finally few use cases from my experience. So imagine yourself being on a e-commerce website. So most of the e-commerce websites these days have millions of products on their catalog. So the company has to recommend few relevant products from their existing millions of items to you. So it would help the company to drive their sales because he is recommending the relevant products to you. And it also helps the user because less time on the website, I mean, go get the relevant products, come out. I mean, lots of increased user satisfaction. So what's the challenge here? So you have millions of users, millions of products, and everyone, each one of us have our own unique taste, and the products, even the products have a huge number of varieties. So at the given scale, I mean, you can't try solving this problem using maybe a regression problem with a regression for every particular product in your catalog or even manually. So at the given, if you want to apply any of the machine learning techniques to solve this particular problem at hand, so that falls under recommender systems. So if you mathematically represent the problem, so this is how it would be. You have users on one side of the matrix, and you have products on the other side of the matrix. So I mean, here we have considered maybe a 10 by 7 matrix, but usually you have millions of users and millions of products. So and the user might have purchased very few items, maybe 3, 5, 10. So for the company to recommend items from their catalog to the user, they should know what his ratings would be for all the other items in the catalog. So the company would want to know the million products in the catalog minus the purchased few items, maybe 5 or 10. Then they can sort the predicted ratings in the descending order, and then maybe send out a few customized marketing messages or how they want to do it, maybe through sidebar messages or whatever it is. So it's all about predicting a million minus few rated items. Yeah, as I've said, I mean, you can't solve this using regression, and you definitely can't solve when you have the sparse data. But you have the advantage because if you solve it through regression, you can interpret the coefficients which you get. Whereas here, it might be tough because you're just, it's a mathematical problem. You have a sparse matrix, you're getting another matrix which is completely filled, which is a huge matrix. But so manually interpreting it might be really tough here. So coming to the most popular recommender systems, you have a collaborative filtering and content-based recommender systems. So collaborative filtering is all about similarity, user similarity. So if you take a user-based collaborative filtering, it's all about clustering users who are similar to the other users. So you cluster users, and if I did not buy any product which the other users in my cluster have bought, so it's all about recommending that product to me. Likewise, item-based. So you cluster all the items, and if I have purchased a good number of items in the cluster, so it's all about recommending other items in the cluster which are not bought by the customer. So I mean, it's all about, you could see groceries. I mean, usually they're very common in nature. So if you miss out a few items from the which are purchased by other households, you can very well recommend them. Whereas here, it's like bedsheet and pillow. I mean, they go together. Coming to the content-based recommendation systems, here you consider the metadata of the items. So if you consider books, it could be the publisher, the author, the year in which it has been published, the genre, the number of pages, stuff like that. So you consider the metadata of the items in coming up with recommendations. So now, I mean, we'll solve a simple collaborative filtering problem. So let's assume you have users and products, and these are the ratings. You assume that the ratings are in this range of 1 to 5. So I purchased few items, and I've rated items in the scale of 1 to 5. So you'd want to know what item you'd want to recommend to maybe a user 1, because you don't know what his rating is for the item 2, maybe item 4, item 5. So if you're doing a item-based collaborative filtering, what you would do is you construct this item-item similarity matrix, where what you calculate is the similarity of item 1 to all the each item to every other corresponding item in the catalog. That's what you compute. Here, you can't compute because for the item 2, if you take the item 2, which is product 2, that is this row, second and third columns, there are no intersections, as you could see. You have 3 there, and there is no rating for the no rating here, likewise no rating here, likewise you have no rating here. So it could also be a cold start problem. I mean, if very few purchases are made, ideally this would not be the case. So I made the matrix really small. So if that's the case, you never know how similar item 1 is to item 2. You also don't know how similar, and as you could see, this is a diagonally symmetric matrix. So all the values on the bottom are similar to the values at the top. So once you compute this, and for similarity, you could use maybe a cosine similarity, Euclidean distance, Pearson. You could use any metric, as it's your choice. So once you have the similarity score computed, you can calculate the final values for all the sparse values. So you could compute all the sparse values, I mean, based on these. So user 1 has purchased item, I mean, product 1 and product 3. So you know how product 1 is similar to other products. You could see these values and then compute what his recommendations would be for the other items in the catalog. Likewise, it would be the same thing for the user-based collaborative filtering. You compute the user-user similarity. How similar am I to all the other users in the database? So you could see there are few null values because there is no matching. You couldn't compute it. So that's a cold start problem. Likewise, there could be few popularity bias. I mean, few people have very unique taste, and it's really tough to match them. I mean, every other user in the system rates it really low. This guy rates it higher. I mean, can't help it. So I mean, unless there is another similar guy exactly who is mimicking his behavior. So coming to the content-based recommendations, as I said, you consider the metadata of the items. So like here, you could see the you consider author, publisher, book release of the year, and each user is nothing but, so the user is nothing but the profile of the item. So if I'm rating all the books by rolling very high, so in a way, my profile could be said as something as I'm more of a Rowling fan. So in a way, it's as simple as any other new release of Rowling, maybe you could be recommended of it. So the user profile is composed of the item properties. So here, since you have a item profile, so given any new item coming into the system, you could compute a simpler cosine distance or any other similarity metric between these two things and find out his affinity towards the new item which is coming into the system. So there is no kind of cold problem per se. And we can also provide a good meaningful explanation, because so if I'm recommending something to this guy, I know why I'm recommending him, because I've rated all the Rowling books very high. So that's the reason why I'm recommending him another newly Rowling book which has been published. And the con being getting the metadata, it's not as easy to get the metadata as we think in the e-commerce. I mean, sometimes it's the metadata is really not so easy to get. I mean, we could see the talk on index. I mean, the things they've been doing to get the metadata, maybe extract the image features. So, I mean, as we know, the higher the features, I mean, better it is. And till now, we've considered either user-user similarities, item-item similarities. What if we consider the interactions between users and items both at a time? So let's assume had this matrix not been sparse. Let's assume every user has bought every item in the catalog and every item has been bought. So in that case, maybe we could have used an SVD and we could explain the direction, I mean, the interactions which have been happening between the users and the items. Since the matrix has been sparse, so you use an alternating least squares approach to solve this particular problem. So simply put, what you do in alternating least squares is you initialize two random matrices and you optimize the objective function. The objective function being the known ratings minus the ratings which are there in the compute randomly generated matrix. So this is the error which you have. So you know few ratings, you generated a completely full matrix. So you compute the root mean square error. I mean, this rating minus this rating whole square. It's all about minimizing that particular error with a so you do solve it maybe using a stochastic gradient descent with choosing a particular alpha rate and approaching reaching the optimum value. One simple assumption being the interactions between users and items can never cross the number of items or the number of users in the system, because you're creating so if the sparse matrix is of size m by n, so you would create m cross k and k cross n. So the k should always be less than m and n both. So this is how you would solve it. And to make it more complex, you could also consider the user bias. So let's assume if I'm a Rajinikanth fan, irrespective of how good or bad the movie being, the content of the movie, I tend to rate Rajinikanth movies higher. So I have a particular bias towards Rajinikanth movies. Likewise, you could have an item bias. Let's assume a particular product has been hit in the market. So the immediate product in the market usually tends to get high ratings. So that could be the item bias. So you would want to eliminate these from the ratings. Or else you could have a time varying impact. I mean, if you could see, if you go into the IMDb, all the newly released movies have very high ratings as soon as they're released. But with time, the rating decays. I mean, they tend to fall. So, I mean, this could be called SVD++, and right now Netflix is using an ensemble of SVD++ and restricted Boltzmann machines. So, this kind of does really well with the accuracies. I mean, now that we've talked about four types of recommendation systems, I mean, when would you want to use what? Let's assume if your item catalog is really huge, even though you don't want to go for the matrix factorization because the computations are really high. As soon as a new item gets into the matrix, you'd want to do the entire matrix computation again. You want to do the matrix factorization, which might take a good amount of time. In the real world, you obviously have millions of users and millions of items. So maybe it's better to stick to collaborative filtering. When you have metadata of the items, which is really rare in the real world, maybe definitely use it. Go for the content-based collaborative filtering, content-based recommendation systems. And if accuracies are the key, maybe matrix factorization. Yeah, for cold start problem, let's assume a new product has entered your catalog. No guy has brought it. So what would you do? So you can cluster all your existing items and maybe just give it the same, attribute it the same value what the other items have. Or combining methods to ensembles. I mean, we know, I mean, you could very well boost the accuracies with ensembles. Even though the accuracies are really low, the ensemble model will definitely have a higher accuracy. And data processing, I mean, maybe removing the average. I mean, you could see people usually complain saying a particular instructor always scores all the students low. A particular instructor, has, even though you do fairly okay, he rates higher. So maybe you want to remove the average from all the ratings. As I've said earlier, I mean, Netflix is using an ensemble of SVD++ and RBMs. From my observation, I've noticed that it's very simple to produce reasonable recommendations, but it takes really good effort to improve them, I mean, to increase the recommendation. To make the recommendations great, or I mean, maybe I worked on a so while I was I've done a consulting project where a particular company is hosting a meet with all its executives, and the tables are arranged in such a manner where and they wanted to figure out who would be sitting in the table. I mean, which kind of users gel together. Maybe if you make a, I mean, I don't know. I mean, they might have thought that people from diverse backgrounds may not gel well. That might have been their assumption, whatever. Something might have been going in their mind, and they want to have the best seating arrangement for them. And the data which you got from the firm was just the employee first name, last name, and the company he belongs to. So we solved this problem by scraping the skill set data from the LinkedIn. So usually most of the top executives, they maintain a LinkedIn profile page updated. So we scrape the skill set. And the problem with the skill set is we could have clustered users had this matrix not been sparse. I mean, I have all the attributes. I know all the skills. I mean, I could have easily clustered them. But this matrix is sparse. I mean, a particular guy knows Julia, SAS, R, Hive, SQL, and DB. There are only two users. So a guy knows Hive and DB, DB meaning database. The other guy said, I know Hive, SQL, and database. So it's very intuitive that even he knows SQL. So we want this sparse matrix to be filled. So that would be a one. And maybe since this guy doesn't know SAS, so the other values would be zero. So using the matrix factorization, we filled the entire matrix, and then we went for a hierarchical clustering, and that's how we got the seating arrangement fixed. And maybe you could recommend R packages based on the packages which you have already installed. Or in the financial domain, usually people have multiple maintain multiple credit cards, and they use each credit card for a particular category. So the numbers are the dollar values, U1, U2 are the users, and flight, food are the particular categories in which they've spent money. So the values are a bit normalized, not normalized, actually hidden actually. So those are the dollar values. So for the company, credit card company to cross sell, they should identify how much he is spending in the other category. That's when I get to know I can cross sell to him. So let's assume if you solve by matrix factorization, so you, the first time you see are the random values, the values generated in the range of 3 to 5, and then you keep minimizing the root mean square error. So after, these are the iterations for a particular value of alpha, and at the end you reach a stage where the random matrix values, which are the values in the flight and user 2, will tend to 3 actually, usually. It's 4, yeah, it's 3. And it's 6. So this has reached that final stage where the root mean square error is almost nearer to 0. So now you know what he's actually spending in the other categories. Now the credit card company can go hit that guy who is spending really high in the other categories, because now I know based on his similarity to other users, you consider the interactions. And maybe you can generate the marketing list and then maybe assume a 10% lift. And yeah, that's it. Yeah, thanks, guys.